Hi, it's Brian Gregg, back with another screencast on D3. Today we're going to be taking our D3 application and breaking it up into a more modular format. And we are going to be adding in some additional functionality to make our visualization more interactive, more user-focused, and just prettier to look at. You know, something that's going to be more appealing to people who are using it, a little bit more informative. The last time we worked on this application, we were setting up the axis for our X and Y coordinates, which is pretty much where we're starting out with right here. And off on the right-hand side over here, the main difference you're going to see with the page is that we've added in some buttons up at the top here for total, males, females, all ages, under 50 and over 50. You can see where we've added those here on the HTML document. We've added in the 6 buttons. And these are going to be what we use some of our, a little bit later on, we're going to add some listeners for those buttons that are going to allow us to change and scale the data in our graph respectively. So we'll get to that in just a little bit. Aside from that, we've also set up a main.css. where we've added in some different styling for bar hover, which is a pseudo class on bar, and tooltips, which tooltips we'll take a look at in a little bit. That's something we're going to set up to give us a little bit more information about our data that we're looking at by hovering over those elements. And we'll get to that shortly. Now, I mentioned at the top of this screencast that we were going to be doing some tweaks to our code to make it more modular. And when I say some tweaks, I'm using that term lightly. We've actually restructured the entire program here. What we've done is we've created a graph object. This graph object is a global object within our application, which is going to contain a lot of information about our data visualization that we need to reference throughout all of the functions below. And that graph is going to contain an object within it called container. And this container is all of the information about the SVG itself, including our offsets and our height and width, as well as the SVG itself. And then we've got some different members here at the root level for the rects, which is the when we select all of the rectangles, we want to have a reference to that in our object, as well as the X and Y scales and the X and Y axis, which we talked about in the last screencast. We also store a reference to metric. Metric is the current metric that we're looking at. The data set has 3 metrics in it for total, for number of males, and for number of females. So that metric is going to be a string representing which metric we're currently looking at in the data set. And then we've got some member functions here for returning the scaled x value, the scaled y value, and the scaled height of the graph, which is necessary for reusability of code. This way, instead of hard coding these functions within our modules, we can call them many times, which may be necessary if we're re-rendering the page or if we need some of these values for our scales or for our tooltips or elsewhere. Now, down here at the bottom, we've created within our d3.json, where we're pulling in our data, we establish our SVG, and below that we are making a call out to the render function. The render function takes a value of D, which is a reference to our data set, and total, which is a reference to the metric that we want to present in our graph. That render function makes a call to 4 functions within our application: our init, our enter, our update, and our exit. These are the same core structure of the application that we had built out before. We've now just kind of formalized that and put them into their own individual functions within the application. The init function functions very much the same as in the last implementation, with a few exceptions. One is that we are now setting the domain based on the values of age. We're passing that back to D3's min and max functions so that we can get the minimum and maximum age for the data set that we're working with. Before, we had that hard-coded to 0 and 100, but since we're going to be scaling this to look at smaller subsets of age groups, I thought it was worthwhile for us to scale the SVG as well. And everything else remains pretty much the same here. The enter function, again, a lot of what we've done at the top here remains the same. We did add in an attribute for the class. We're setting that class to bar. And the reason why I did that was, as I'd said earlier, to establish a cleaner way of styling these individual bars rather than having to set the attributes for anything that's static. We can now just set those values within the CSS file itself. The Y, height, and X are making calls out to those member functions from our graph object, which I referred to earlier. And we've added in a couple of event listeners here as well for mouse over and for mouse out. So every time you mouse over one of the columns on our graph, it's going to make a call out to this tooltip function. And every time you mouse out, it's going to make a call to this remove tooltip. The tooltip and remove tooltips are defined up here. They're up here with our helper functions. Tooltip is actually going to append a new element, which we haven't looked at in our SVG earlier, which is an element of text. And text is handled the same way as anything else, rectangles or circles or anything else in an SVG element, where you can set attributes on it, and you can define the X and Y coordinates of where it's going to be placed. So what we're doing here is we're taking the value from the object when you're mousing over and passing it to this tooltip function, which is then going to append text with an attribute that's based off of the scaled age for the x-coordinate and the scaled value of the metric for the y-coordinate, assigning the attribute class to tooltip, which is going to help style our tooltip with the appropriate font and font sizes. And then we're setting the text here. The text is actually going to be populated with the age and the value of the metric. The remove tooltip is just going to take that same text and it's going to remove it from our application. So let's go ahead and see what that looks like. When we actually highlight the bars on here, you're going to see two things are going to happen. One, it's going to highlight in blue, and the other, it's going to show a tooltip with the age and the population for the currently selected element. And the color change is because in our CSS, we're assigning a fill color of blue to our bar on the pseudo selector of hover. And the tooltips are because of the call to this function for tooltip, which is appending that SVG. And as I had said earlier, it's calculating the X and Y coordinates. That's why as you get higher up on the graph, you're going to see that the X and Y coordinates for that text adjust accordingly. So you can play around with the styling on this and make it a little bit easier to read, but I think it demonstrates the effect really nicely. So that's the extent of the changes that we've made within our enter function. One other thing I'll note is that we actually have a call out to draw axis, which is another helper function that we have up here. I've just broken this out so that it's a little bit easier to read, a little bit cleaner. And we're actually made some slight modifications to this just to make sure that it's populating based off the values in the graph container for the X offset and the Y offset. and I added this here to remove the scales before the image is re-rendered, just because when we re-render using a smaller data set with only a select number of ages, we want it to clear out this scale before it renders a new scale. Otherwise, they'll overlap each other. So that's our init, that's our enter. In our update phase, again, this is broken out into another function here. One thing I just will make note of, because again, we're going to be scaling this, we want the width of these bars to adjust based on the number of elements that we're displaying. So we set a value w within the update function, which is based off of the length of our data set. And we call our transition with the same duration of 750. And we set the attribute of width to w, which is that value that we calculated up here. And again, we're calling our graph.y, graph.height, and graph.x, which is going to represent the updated data set. And then lastly, we call our exit function, which just does our cleanup. So there it is, our modular version of our application. We've got our object, we've got some helper functions over here, and then we've got our four core functions for that correspond with the four main components of a D3 application. Now below here, we actually have some event listeners that I've set up for each of these individual buttons up here on the screen, which I showed you in the HTML file. Those are going to each call the render function, but passing some different values to it. So when I had stated earlier, when we call our render function, we're passing the data and m, which is a string representing the measure that we want to calculate. So when we click on the total button, we actually want to pass the value of total. And clicking on that is just going to show us the total of all of our population. Male, however, is going to render using a string of males so that our D3 visualization will re-render just for those values for male, and the same thing for females. And again, the tooltips are going to reflect the values for the subset of the data. We've also added some functionality up here for some different age groups. So we've got all ages. Now, just note that I've set this up so that it's always going to pass total for these. So you're not looking at the all ages for males and females. Obviously, you can program the visualization to do that. But for the intents and purposes of this, I just wanted to show some of the different age buckets. So by clicking on the element of over 50, we have an event listener that's going to call the render function. But we're actually passing, instead of just the data set as the first parameter, we're passing a filtered version of the data set. So filter is an array function. It's part of the array prototype in JavaScript, introduced in ECMAScript 5. And this is going to pass a function as a parameter, and that function is going to return the object if the criteria here is met. So for this array, we're only returning those values where age is greater than or equal to 50. So by clicking on this, you'll see that we've now filtered out our data set so that it is only showing those ages for 0 to 50. Same thing for over 50. It is going to show us only those ages that are over 50. And again, all of our functionality for our tooltips and everything are still in place. Let's just put that back to total. And that is it. We have a fully functional data visualization here. It has tooltips, it has scales, it has the ability to filter data, to substitute metrics in, and to visually demonstrate which values you've selected. So this is a pretty powerful graph. I mean, we're just looking at a bar chart here, but given this functionality, you can do quite a bit with it. So hopefully this is something that will help you get started on building out some really creative visualizations using the data that you have accessible to you, and some things that are really interactive and that do a good job of, you know, representing data for your users. All of this data has been published. All of these modules have been published out to GitHub. So, you know, feel free to take a look at those, edit them, fork them, and make your own creations using the data and the layout that I've put here. And, you know, certainly hit me up with questions if you have them. Happy to talk about data, talk about data visualizations in JavaScript, and maybe revisit this with some additional screencasts sometime in the future. Until then, thanks and good night.